It's a bit late, perhaps, but I thought I'd try my hand at doing a best and worst list for the previous
2023.
This is going to work slightly differently from a lot of people's lists, because I'm going to be counting every movie that I saw for the first time in 2023. And I don't feel as though a top and bottom list should be limited to movies that only came out last year, because you're never going to see every movie that came out last year. It's impossible. So better just to have a personal bias list of all the movies that you saw from last year. So, top 5, best and worst. Yay! Starting with number 5 on the bottom list, it's Benedetta. I find myself being very intrigued by movies directed by all-time directors, people that were kind of famous in the 80s and are still making movies to this day. It's always interesting to see whether they still have the ability to create a good movie. A lot of directors, frankly, don't. It's incredibly tonally inconsistent. It's this weird middle ground where I don't really know exactly what the movie wants me to feel at any given point. The explicit nature of the film is obviously like a selling point. But honestly, if you've been on the internet for as long as most people have, it's really weak sauciness. I noticed plenty of dead pixels on the screen, some of which in fairly like important scenes multiple times throughout the movie. It was very distracting. Yeah, fair play to Paul Verhoeven for continuing to make movies. I think that's pretty admirable, but yeah. I've seen worse, I will say, you know, for a man pushing his 90s, I've seen worse movies, but this was really boring and lame. Number 5 on the top 5 is The Dirties. This is Matt Johnson's first feature film. He has an incredible style which manages to mix fiction and reality seamlessly. So this is a movie about high schoolers who are kind of losers and decide to make a film about them killing their high school bullies. It kind of spirals out of control from that point, but I won't spoil it because you should just watch it. This movie deals with a very heavy subject, and I wouldn't call this movie a comedy, but it is very inherently funny and humorous in a lot of ways, while also still managing to incorporate all of the drama and the more serious narrative element. I had kind of a hard time finding this movie to watch anywhere, so that's a shame, but I would definitely recommend seeking it out if you can, and if you enjoy this kind of style of like mockumentary filmmaking, then I'd definitely recommend Matt Johnson's other projects. Number 4 on the bottom list is The Flash. It's not surprising that this is on here, but it is kind of surprising that it wasn't the worst movie that I saw. There were a couple of moments where the movie did manage to either entertain me or, you know, make me laugh, or it did something that I thought, oh, you know what, that's not the worst thing I've ever seen. It isn't the worst superhero movie in the world, but it is such a clusterfuck of so many different elements. You know, you have Ezra Miller, who is a complete piece of shit, and we all knew that going into this movie. That completely sours this film from the very beginning. This movie came after the announcement that the current DC Cinematic Universe was disbanding and that they were going to reboot the whole thing and get James Gunn in to replace Zack Snyder. All of that stuff. It really did just feel like like the nail in the coffin of this type of superhero movie. It feels, even though it only just came out, it feels like a relic of the past. Seems like superhero movies are on the decline and other things are going to start taking their place. And I think The Flash is a perfect encapsulation of why that is a good thing and why we should be celebrating this fact. Number 4 on the top list is The Worst Person in the World. This movie has such a simple plot, which if I described it, it would sound like a million other movies. It's just about a young woman who is attempting to find her place in the world. I think it's superbly written. The main performance is astounding, as well as all the other performances as well. There's a few moments of this movie where it becomes quite abstract, and I feel like it adds so much to this story, which you might say is fairly derivative, or, you know, you've seen it before, you've heard it before. It's able to present it in such a unique way, in such a new way. Also, it has a fantastic soundtrack as well. So number 3 on my bottom list is Smile. I watch a lot of horror movies. I like horror when it's done well. Sadly, it is very rarely ever done well. Smile is a fantastic example of this. It is one of the most derivative horror movies I've ever seen. It has one gimmick that it uses. I mean, even if you are someone who finds this image frightening for some reason, I mean, you will be bored of it by the end of this film, I guarantee. They throw, like, a monster in at the end of it for, like, no real reason. It's just like, oh, well, we need something more exciting to end this movie on. So here's a scary monster. Like, it's a Frankenstein movie of so many other things. If you've never seen a horror movie before in your life, it might be fairly interesting. If you've seen a horror movie in the last 10 years, it has nothing to offer you. It is lame, boring, derivative nonsense. I will also just say at this point that all of my bottom three picks for worst movies are all horror movies, which I've only just realized now. Now it's on to the top three, and number three is Once Upon a Time in the West. For as dated as some of the elements may be, this has got to be one of the most absorbing and atmospheric films I've ever seen. The sense of pacing and editing in this film is insane. Like, it's absolutely incredible, and I've not seen anyone do this type of pacing and editing, and like, the sound design, everything just comes together so perfectly. Man, it's fucking cool as shit. Check it out if you want to. I would recommend giving it a watch at least once, seeing if you click with the pacing. It's a slow movie, but my god. Number two on the worst list. It's the second worst movie or movies that I saw. Yes. It's two of them. This is 47 Meters Down and 47 Meters Down Uncaged. I have to apologize right out the gate to my friend who very kindly recommended that I watch these movies based on our shared interest in sharks. I have to give these movies credit for actually, like, shooting underwater. I think that's probably a real pain in the ass. And I give them props for doing that. I think you described the first movie and even the second movie as like a bubble movie, I think that's the term, where it's like sort of one location and it's classic kind of horror shit. You're trapped in a cage at the bottom of the ocean and there's evil sharks that are gonna kill you. And, you know, if that's all you want out of a film and out of an experience, and if you can just, if the mere idea of being trapped in a cage underwater at the bottom of the ocean is enough to get a rise out of you, you might get something out of at least the first one. For me, it really wears off after a while. The cheapness really gets to me. The ocean floor does not look like the ocean floor. It looks like a pool that has been done up with rocks to make it look like the bottom of the ocean. The second movie really jumps the shark. I can't remember much about the second movie, but there's like, they go into like an underwater cave system and there are sharks that are blind. But I kid you not, they have scenes in the movie where they're like hiding from the sharks. The sharks, like as if they're like hiding from like a blind serial killer. There is a fish jump scare.
Fishy. No, Nicole,
I wouldn't! Yeah, just lame. Really cheap and lame. Annoying characters. Stupid bullshit. It's just lame. I would recommend watching The Descent instead, which is basically the same thing, only not underwater, and also really good. My second favourite film that I saw was Loveless. This is quite a depressing one, so I'd be warned about that before going into it. This is another very slow, atmospheric movie. It's about a couple who are getting a divorce, who end up neglecting their child so bad that the child runs away. And then it's about the manhunt and what that brings out in them and in other people. And I think I just loved how meticulous this movie was with its directing. The way that it establishes characters and the way that it delivers information is so satisfying and so cleverly done. You'll have a character like driving a car, the radio's on, and what's on the radio is like so important to like the themes of the rest of the movie. Like, you get a sense of not only these characters and what they're going through, but you get a sense of the world that they're living in. It's a fantastic movie. Not many people have seen it, and I think it would be regarded a lot more highly if people had seen it a bit more. Go out and watch it if you want a nice depressing time. Nice depressing old little time. Okay, what's the worst movie that I saw last year then? Well, I'll tell you what it is. Number one on my bottom five is Exorcist The Believer, or The Exorcist Believer? I can't remember which way around that goes. This movie is a massive piece of shit, and it would be a massive piece of shit if it were not attached to one of the greatest movies of all time, but it is also that. Apparently David Gordon Green has been sort of fired or removed from the project going forward. Have two other sequels in the works that are no longer going to be directed by him, apparently, so that's fairly hopeful, but man, you know, just stop now, I would say. I made a review on this movie, which is sadly not available to watch because it got copyright struck by Universal, which is why the footage you're seeing right now is probably going to be really weird and look odd because I'm trying to avoid the content ID system on YouTube. Thank you for that, Universal. It's such a boring movie and I really struggle to actually say anything of note. I think I'm just gonna leave the review just like in limbo for now. This will serve as a good enough analysis of the film. It's a piece of shit. It's really boring. It's not scary. It's lame. It is embarrassing. It's laughable. Anyway, I'm done talking about bad movies. I'm done talking about bad horror movies. I hope I can see some better horror movies this year, because it was pretty slim pickings last year. Alright, number one. My favourite movie that I saw last year has to be Lawrence of Arabia.
Only two kinds of creature get fun in the desert. Bedouins and gods, and you're neither. Take it from me. For ordinary men, it's a burning, fiery furnace.
No, Dryden. It's going to be fun.
It is recognized that you have a funny sense of fun.
Again, this movie's only real flaw, much like Once Upon a Time in the West, is some of the more culturally sensitive things that happen in the movie. The brown face is not particularly appreciated in this day and age, for good reason. You know, if that's a hurdle that is going to be too high to overcome for you, then I can completely understand that and I completely appreciate that. I'm able to sort of turn my mind into 1964, something like that, and I'm able to just absorb myself in the characters. But I can understand if that is an issue for some people. This movie, though, is really just an astounding piece of work. It's almost 4 hours long and it just never lets up. The first minute to the last minute, it is a precise character study, and I won't spoil where the movie goes, but it has some of the most narratively satisfying conclusions that you could ask for. The reincorporation is absolutely fantastic. There's not a single moment that feels wasted. I'm someone who appreciates films from older periods of time, but I am not someone who thinks that a movie deserves extra credit necessarily, or that my opinion of a film should be higher just because a movie's older. There are plenty of films that I've seen from the 60s or the 70s that just do not click with me, and that I find to be dated, and that I can't really get on with. So it's always really exciting when you watch a movie from this long ago that still feels so punchy and has so much to offer. Peter O'Toole is absolutely amazing. It's such a fantastic central performance, and it has to be, because you are following this character for 4 hours. Anyway, it's an epic movie. It's super engaging. Just a properly fantastic movie, and it is deserving of its place in cinema history, I think. So yeah, that's my list of 2023. I hope it was somewhat informative. I hope that maybe I talked about some movies that you maybe didn't know about or that you might want to check out now because I mentioned them. I hope this new year brings lots of good new movies. I'm sure it will. Thank you. Goodbye. Bye.